लाइव गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आप सबको अक्षय तृतीया की बहुत बहुत बधाई। आई अर्चित वासुदेवा वेलकम यू ऑल टू आवर सेकंड वर्चुअल स्टडी सर्कल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ अधिवक्ता परिषद दिल्ली हाई कोर्ट यूनिट।
नमस्कार सभी को। वी हैड आवर फर्स्ट वर्चुअल स्टडी सर्कल ऑन 14th ऑफ अप्रैल 2020 एंड द टॉपिक वाज वर्चुअल हियरिंग एंड द स्पीकर वाज Senior Advocate Aman Lekhi, ASD of India, and that study circle got grand success, and it was watched by maximum 10,000 people on Facebook.
Thank you, Archana ma'am. So the topic for today's discussion is effective implementation of mediation in India, the way forward. And we have here with us a very distinguished personality and a former judge of the Delhi High Court, Justice G.S. Sistani. So before starting with the study circle, I would be giving you a short introduction of the topic, starting with the meaning. So what is mediation? Mediation is a voluntary process where the disputing parties mutually decide to resolve their dispute by appointing a mediator. So for Indians, mediation is not a new experience for the people of our country. It has been prevalent in India since time immemorial. In olden times, mediation cells were popularly known as panchayats and where mukhyas and sarpanches used to be the mediators. So what is the need of the mediation? As we all know, India is the second most populated country in the world, and due to so much of liberalization and globalization, there is a tremendous economic growth, which has led to explosion of litigation in country. So the need was felt to amend the act. So in 1996, the Indian Parliament amended the Civil Procedure Code and introduced Section 89, which empowered the courts to direct settlement of disputes by mediation. Thereafter, mediation is encouraged very strongly by our courts in India. Many high courts and trial courts have been set up with the mediation centers within the premises of the court. And I'm very happy to say that huge number of lawyers and others have been trained to become mediators. Very importantly, the process of mediation is cheap and free for the parties. And one more important thing, that a large number of cases are referred to the mediation, specifically commercial litigation, which involve high stakes. So coming to the benefit of the mediation, it is cost effective and it is an informal platform where people can talk informally and resolve their issues. And most importantly, it is time saving. So, considering the present situation, that is the post-COVID situation, I can only say that we have been given a chance to explore this virtual world where we can connect with anyone at any point of time. So now, without wasting much of your time, I would request Archana ma'am to come forward and introduce our speaker.
Thank you so much, Archit. Today we have among us very eminent speaker, Honorable Justice G.S. Sistani. Though sir doesn't need any introduction, but to follow the protocol of our Adhivakta Parishad, I would like to say few things about sir. Sir got elevated as a judge in 2006 of Honorable Delhi High Court. And in his tenure of about 14 years, we were lucky enough to have sir in almost all the jurisdiction of the court. Justice Sistani has been part of various committees of High Court, including Chairman of Delhi High Court Mediation Center. Sir is a trained mediator and he received his training from Pepperdine University, America. Though sir got retired on 10th of March 2020 from the court, not from our heart, and he is still working for the Mediation Center and doing mediations today also in this pandemic era through video conferences. As a judge, sir made his level best to resolve the matters amicably, especially family disputes. Even the advice orders passed by sir were never pinched. The reason behind the way orders were discussed and the evergreen smile on her face. This introduction may take at least 1 hour. So without wasting your time, I would like to invite Honorable Justice G.S. Astani ji to enlighten us on today's topic. Sir, you are most welcome on this virtual stage. Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar. Thank you, Archit and Archana, for such a wonderful introduction. I'm happy to be here this afternoon, and my warm wishes to all the viewers who are giving me this graveyard session and are sacrificing their nap time. But the topic is extremely interesting. This is a topic of interest not only for the lawyers, but I think mediation is something which we see around since our childhood days. To start with, I want to take you back to the year 2005-2006, when the mediation movement really started. You know, there was a lot of apprehension amongst the lawyer community, and I think they were fairly justified in feeling the sense of insecurity, because none of us really knew what this mediation was all about. What was in store for us as lawyers? I was a practicing advocate then myself. We didn't know what it really meant. We had no idea where it would take us. And thus there was a doubt in the mind of every lawyer that maybe the mediators and the mediation would take over a lot of our work. So at that time, at the relevant time, Justice Karju, who was then the Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court, he, along with the then president of the bar, took up this challenge and decided to give it a shot. The first mediation center came up in the Delhi High Court in the month of April 2006. There has been no looking back. The center started with 2 rooms. Some of you who would have been around would have a rough idea. It was on the ground floor. And with passage of time, the mediation center is now in 2 floors, including the 2 rooms which we had on the ground floor have also expanded. This is just to give you an idea that how the mediation movement began and where do we stand today. Most of you as lawyers would be aware that Section 89 of CPC was introduced in 2018. Now the Commercial Courts Act has been amended. Section 12A has been included, which talks about compulsory mediation. Of course, the 2018 amendment gives an option to invoke mediation, pre-litigation mediation. This is mandatory, except in cases where urgent relief is sought. So in 2005-2006, as Anchit was giving you a background, that mediation was thought that it would be part of the ADR system. It would be a tool to help us resolve disputes through mediation, and in effect, the docket busting would be helped. The idea was that a lot of cases would be resolved through mediation and the pressure over the courts would be lessened. Friends, for the past more than 2.5 years, whenever I have spoken, I have said, please don't treat mediation as a spare tire. Don't treat mediation as a stepney. Over the years, we have made a place for ourselves. We are here to stay. We are not a stepney. We will go hand in hand in resolving disputes, which we have. The success rate of the Delhi High Court Mediation Center Samadhan is more than 60%, barring those cases which are non-starters. So, what is mediation all about? Who is a mediator? What are the qualities of a mediator? Why is there so much of people harping about mediation? The objective of mediation is ultimately to resolve disputes as early as possible. So the moot question which comes up is, what is the advantage of mediation? See, when a litigant approaches a lawyer, he has reached his wit's end. He's tried whatever is possible. So finally he reaches the lawyer with this hope and trust that when he goes to court, the matter will be resolved by the judges. Now, during the pendency of the matter, suddenly a suggestion comes up from the court that I am referring the matter to mediation. So an ordinary litigant would have no idea what mediation is all about. So he is extremely apprehensive. Besides being apprehensive, there is also an element of doubt. Am I being relegated? I have decided to come to the High Court or the lower court. Why am I being sent to another forum? Will I have to pay more money? Will the person be impartial? Will he at all listen to me? Am I going to be bound by the terms of settlement? See, the courts may or may not have enough time to explain this to a client. Similarly, a counsel may not be able to give enough time to a litigant to explain to him as to why mediation. Why is the court relegating your dispute to another forum? So friends, we have heard, as Anchetan also said, that mediation is inexpensive, it saves time. But you know, some of the real advantages of mediation are that it's mainly the parties who negotiate amongst themselves to resolve the dispute. There are two very important factors which I want to highlight as to the advantages of mediation. One is finality. As you all know, that initial, for example, whether it's a commercial matter or a family matter. In a family matter, you may start with a petition seeking divorce. You may have multiple litigations, 498A, 406. In some terrible cases, you may have some other sections which have become very popular nowadays. Then there are cross FIRs. In my long experience, I have seen how cases multiply. So, in case of one successful mediation, There may be finality of 10, 12, 14 matters, civil and or criminal, of course, barring the ones in which there cannot be settlement through mediation. Those sections you are aware, we do not need to go with respect to those sections at this stage. The second most important fact which I want to flag and highlight, and which I will elaborate upon a little later, and that is preservation of a relationship. We will come back to both these features a little later. But before that, now if I have to sit down and resolve my own dispute, why do I need a mediator? Is it as simple as that? What does the mediator do? What is expected out of a mediator? What are the qualities of a mediator? After all, we are canvassing that mediation is the way to go. So we must justify all this. So this mediator, he facilitates the communication between the parties. He helps them to reach a decision. And mind you, mediator is not meant to do some thanedari. He is not supposed to force a decision. It is not the job of the mediator even to suggest. That is the job of the parties and their lawyers. So it's not really the mediator to say that I think this is the best settlement for you and you should settle the matter. I don't think that's the objective. And in fact, during the mediation training, this is discouraged. So now the question is that once the mediation starts, the parties come before the mediator. It is at this point that the mediator must explain his role to the parties. And therefore, the first hearing in a mediation session is one of the most important hearings. It is during this hearing that the parties have many questions which the mediator must answer. First and foremost, he must explain to the parties that he is a completely impartial person. He has no concern either with the dispute or with any of the parties. He must win this confidence of the parties. Then he must explain his role. Importantly, the mediator must also explain to the parties that he may have a session independent with one of the parties in the absence of the other parties, which means that during a mediation session, he may tell party A that you please wait outside, I want to hear party B. Or he may tell party B subsequently, now I've heard you, you please wait outside, I would like to hear party A. Because if this is not explained, then a client, a litigant may feel insecure during the mediation proceedings and wonder as to why the mediator is talking to a party in the room alone and in his absence. Because such a thing does not happen in the court. In the court, in open court, the judge hears both the parties. The judge will never tell one of the parties to go out. I'm going to hear only the plaintiff or the defendant. So this is where the role of the mediator comes in. That he must explain what are his duties and how he is going to go through the mediation proceedings. There is another important aspect about mediation proceedings, and that is there are times that the parties have not spoken to each other. And I normally call this as the see you in court syndrome. That happens primarily in commercial matters. You find that manager of A company may write to the manager of B company and saying that the goods which you supplied are faulty. And during this conversation, manager A may hit the ego of manager B or vice versa. Since it's an impersonal relationship, it's not really going to affect the manager on his own. So out of the blue, one person will say, see you in court. Now, this is a perfect example in some commercial matters. There are also family matters where two brothers or other siblings, for different reasons, may have stopped talking to each other. I will come down to...
Sir, can I interrupt you for a second? Sir, can you pull your camera? Sir, can you just pull your camera down a bit?
Okay.
Because the question is coming on the screen and your face will not be seen. Now it's fine, sir. Now it's fine.
Is it all right now? All right. So, let me give you an example. I was hearing a family matter. It was a partition suit. There was a single property. There were two brothers. So I felt that there was no reason as to why the proceedings should go on when it was pretty certain that both parties had equal share. So I asked the counsels to call the parties to court. So both the brothers came to court. They were senior citizens. In fact, the older brother seemed to be in his late 70s. The younger brother was in mid 70s. So out of nowhere, I just looked at both of them. I said, you both have 50% share each. There's one property. What is your objection to partition? So the older brother stood up. He looked at me and he said, isne kabhi mujhse apna hissa manga hi nahi. So I was quite surprised by this answer. And so I looked at the younger brother and said, aapne kabhi bhai sahab se apna hissa manga? He said, ji, ye to mere se 10 saal se baat hi nahi karte. To main hissa kahan se mangu? So in a very simple way, I looked at the older brother and I said that agar ye aapse hissa mangenge to aap de denge. So he said, ye abhi mange, main abhi de deta. So there was laughter in the court, and all you lawyers know that the buzz starts immediately. So I asked the younger brother, aap apne bhai sahab ke paas aaiye aur inko adab se apna baat kariye inse. So he looked at his brother and he said, dekho bhai sahab, aapko pata hai mere bacche bade ho gaye hain, inke paas rehne ki jagah nahi hai, aapko ye sab cheeze maloom hai, aur abhi to iske ghar mein ek baby bhi ho gaya hai, और हम कहाँ इनको वहां पे रखें. सो ही सेड के तूने तो मुझे मिठाई भी नहीं भेजी. तो एंड सो द सीन बिकेम अ लिटिल सेंटिमेंटल. एंड टू कट द लॉन्ग स्टोरी शॉर्ट, ए डिक्री ऑफ पार्टीशन वॉज पास्ड. एंड बिफोर गोइंग सो आई सेड, मेक श्योर आप दोनों एक ही घर जा रहे हो, एक ही गाड़ी में जाना. A formula which I would follow almost in all matters where I felt there was somewhat chances of settlement. Sometimes it was dangerous also, but By far it worked. And now this was a perfect example where there was complete lack of communication. Similarly, in some commercial matters also I felt, and I would normally say that responsible persons from the company who are in a position to take a decision to remain present in court. And if the goods were defective or short supplied or not as per specification, I would say sit outside, you talk to each other. If there's any problem, I would just point out to any lawyer whom I felt would be a good mediator. And I said, he will sit outside with you. And if there are any questions, he would answer. So when I was talking initially, I said two issues I'm going to flag. And one of the important issues which I said, it said preservation of relationship. You know, these are examples where people go back having cured their differences. They go back to restart their lives in a different way. This happens a lot in family matters, some disputes pertaining to husband and wife, some custody matters we've seen. But let me also tell you another aspect of mediation, which I have highlighted and said many, many times. Cure the problem. Don't put a band-aid. I have seen in a large number of family matters where parties come to court and the standard line is, देखो तुम्हारी शादी को 10 साल हो गए हैं, तुम्हारा एक बेबी भी है, सोचो तुम्हारा नहीं तो इसका क्या होगा, तो अपना नहीं सोचो तो बच्चे की वजह से कम आप लोग इकट्ठे हो जाओ, तो चलिए आप अपना ठीक ठाक रहिए, कोई बात नहीं, ये छोटी मोटी चीजें होती जाती है. फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज एन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ पुटिंग अ बैंडेड, बिकॉज आइदर ऑफ द पार्टी रियली नोज where the shoe is pinching. If the husband has a problem or the wife has a problem, this band-aid is not going to work. This is going to come off and they will be back either to their fist fights or whatever. So we've not really solved anything. We've probably just adjourned the matter, or we've just tried to scuttled the matter for the moment and said, therefore, as I keep saying, a mediator cannot be a man in a hurry. You can't have a mediator who's sitting for a mediation session and whose mind is in X court or a Y court. His heart, his soul, his thought process, all must be in that mediation room. He must sit there and ensure that he has enough time to hear the parties. Now, this hearing the parties is also a very important business, huh? And let me tell you why. See, when there is a dispute, the man goes to the lawyer, and you know, we are a very busy lot. So don't expect a litigant who has unchanneled thoughts, whose thoughts are not in place. You know, he's not made a list of dates. So sometimes he will start by saying, "Dekho ji, jab hamari shaadi hui thi na, tab se ye baat," and he'll end up 20 years later ki story. So nobody has the time to hear. Then he reaches the court. And the story of the court, we all know. There are 50 matters, 70 matters. There are people breathing down your throat. Now you can't sit down and hear the Ram Katha of each person. Now, sometimes the elderly want to explain, let us say a service matter. Old uncle ji wants to tell his son that why his pension is 15 rupees less, or why he was not given promotion 20 years back. But who has the time? So if the family does not have time, if the lawyer does not have time, if the court does not have time, and if the mediator says, even I don't have the time, then where should the litigant go? So I keep underlining in every mediation conference, mediators, please be patient. Please be tolerable. Please be understanding. Feel some pain and then see how it is to be resolved. Any one of these ingredients is missing, don't expect a good dish. I know all of you are cooking in this lockdown. So any one ingredient goes, don't expect the mediation to move on. Probably it is only in the mediation session will any party get the first opportunity to pour his heart out. Don't stop him. Let him say what he wants to. Let him be frank. I have seen in mediation when a lawyer or a relation trying to prompt and the man saying, Ruk jao ji, mujhe bahut saalon ke baad bolne ka mauka laga hai. To usko mauka dijiye. To ye mediation karta hai. This is what mediation can do. Now, the second issue which I had flagged, all this is, I'm telling you as to why mediation, and that was preservation of relationship. Now, how does this affect preservation of relationship? I had a dispute with X. After all, in mediation, we are not doing only family matters. And I had one dispute. If it gets resolved, very good. Why am I so interested in preserving a relationship? Let me give you a live example. This probably happened in Justice Sikri's court, and he always gives this example. See, there was a trademark dispute. And a suit had been filed in the High Court. The local commissioner was appointed. Goods were confiscated. Somebody was making spurious jeans with the brand of a very well-known company. I don't remember the name of the company. So after some time, it was deemed appropriate to resolve the matter through mediation. So during this mediation session, the parent company said that I have examined the goods which you are making under my brand and without my permission. And I find the quality of the material and the stitching to be excellent. So why are you doing this to my company? Why didn't you establish your own brand? So, you will not believe it. During mediation, it was resolved between the parties that this man would supply jeans to the parent company because the parent company felt that the material and the quality was so good. So, what did mediation do? This is a perfect example of preservation of relations. When husband and wife decide to bury the dispute and go back, not after that band-aid, no? You have preserved the relationship. And who can do this? The forum of mediation. You may get a paper decree. A paper decree will not preserve your relationship. You may probably get an extra 1% interest or 2% interest. Now see in contrast, parties resolve through mediation, even a commercial matter. No supplying goods. But he says, I have supplied goods to you or worked with you for 20 long years. Today I am passing through a bad phase. I am not in a position to return the money with 18%. Sir, can you help me? If the relationship is good, the man will say, all right, forget 18%, return my principal, and I will give you some time to pay nominal interest. What has taken place? You have negotiated, not by writing, I will see you in court, but you have sat across the table. Another reason why he could be pressing for his money is the period of limitation. If he does not go to court, he may know you're a good man. But if the limitation expires, then he will have a right, but he will be without any remedy. It is therefore, looking into these aspects in mind, that pre-litigation mediation started. And I want to share with you that even in the High Court Mediation Center, Samadhan, there has been an excellent success rate in pre-litigation mediation. And now, as I was explaining, with the amendment to Section 12 of the Commercials Code Act, it has become mandatory to first go through pre-mediation litigation, and only then you will be able to appear and your plaint will be accepted. Well, let it be very clear that pre-litigation mediation in Section 12A nowhere takes away your right for any urgent matter or any urgent listening. There can be so many urgent reliefs which a man may want. He may want an injunction. He may want a stay against demolition. He may want the property injunction against sale of the property. So this pre-litigation mediation will not come in your way. Of course, Section 12 only deals with the Commercials Courts Act, not any other act. But even in other matters, so we have thought of various ways where people should be encouraged, and we must give enough publicity to mediation. In fact, when this topic was being discussed, I had shared my views that you don't need an elaborate setup for mediation. You can have mediation camps. You can go to the interiors. See, disputes not only mean large disputes. A person who has a LIG one-room flat and has two sons and they are fighting with each other, it's a daily problem. So if you organize mediation camps, if you have the correct volunteers, if you take some training in mediation, you will be able to help people in their day-to-day lives. There are sometimes one parent who's staying with one sibling and he does not get any opportunity. That sibling is holding on to him. He will not allow him to meet the other family members. And he may not have the resource to approach a lawyer. See, that's where your role comes. You can expand this. You can expand this to every, let us say, district. You can have district mediation centers. And similarly, all our trial courts, they are doing an excellent job. But the Delhi High Court Mediation Center is a unique mediation center which is run by lawyers. So the entire success of the mediation in the Delhi High Court goes to lawyers. It does not go to the judges' community. The judges have only an overseeing committee. The entire mediation center is run by lawyers alone. I'm not aware if how many of you people are aware of this fact. And there are excellent mediators. I want to share with you that Supreme Court has marked not once, a number of time cases to some of our mediators, our trained mediators. While the fees in the mediation center may not be very high, but private mediation, the fees may be as high as in arbitration. You have lawyers who pursue arbitration. There are lawyers who are arbitrators. There are lawyers who are mediators. So therefore, this is, according to me, a way to go. According to me, it's no longer your stepney. It's no longer to be treated as a stepmotherly treatment to say that, all right, we will now, we have too many cases, let's send some to mediation, all right. No. Every matter is not a matter which can be resolved through mediation. I will give you an example. I had a client when I was a lawyer, and in fact, he remained my client till I got elevated. He had married one lady. He says his story was that she was in the village and they showed me the picture of X and got me married to Y. Very frankly, I didn't believe this story. But since I was a lawyer, then I had to buy this story. So the parties stayed apart. Then he sought a divorce and an ex parte decree was granted. So when the lady came to know about the ex parte decree, she contested. But by this time, this man had remarried and had two children. So it is at appellate stage that this man had contacted me. So for many, many years, in fact, after every hearing, firstly, the judge used to have a big laugh that how come, you know, you have two wives, and half the time the lawyers in the courtroom didn't know whether the judge was referring to me or the client. So each time I had to explain, no, I have only one. And the lady had only one answer. She was from the village. She said, I don't want to die as a divorcee. So every court would explain to her that, dekho, ab inke do bacche hain aur ye aap to rakh nahi sakte, kya hoga? So she used to say, nahin, koi baat nahin, inko bolo mujhe usi ghar mein rakh le aur main wahin reh lun. Until, as far as I remember, I don't know what happened to the case finally, but that lady did not agree for any settlement. Now, if as a judge, you have talked to the party and you realize that one of the parties is not open for a settlement, as a lawyer, you can see that happening. Don't agree for mediation. Because you're only going to delay the matter. You're going to waste your time. You're going to waste the time of the mediator. So judges, when they refer a matter to mediation, they first give a little test. And it is during this test that you realize whether the person is ready for a settlement, whether the person has any intent of a settlement. Because, you know, some of these people have this Hindi movie dialogue, no? Main isko maza chaka ke rahunga ya maza chaka ke rahungi. And mind you, there are people like that. And I have dealt with some matters. Except for maybe one family matter where the lady in somewhat similar circumstances did not want to settle. But during the course of one chamber hearing, she had asked, it was a division bench, so she asked us for a hearing without the other side. So we asked her, and she said that he had neglected her and he had left her to fend for herself. And she said, now I have a son who's grown up, and that seemed to be the turning point. So we asked her that in case this man is willing to provide money or say a shop or something for his future. She said, if this man gives me 50 lakhs for me to establish my son's career, I will grant him a divorce. So we thought the figure was very, very high, because the man didn't seem, that was our first impression. So then when we talked to him in private, we were surprised that he started with 30 lakhs. And the real reason seemed to be the pressure of his second wife. So we were quite taken aback. We thought he would never be able to pay more than 15 lakhs, maximum 20 lakhs. And we were wrong. So the matter was settled for 35 lakhs. And the man paid 35 lakhs. And it actually proved us wrong. We thought that this lady would never settle. But when we sat down and for half an hour, uninterrupted, when we heard the lady's story, when we heard that all the difficulties she had gone through to establish her son, to send him to school, and how her parents had supported her, how her brother was supporting her, it was during this we realized that now she was really more concerned with the future of her son, and divorce was taking a back seat, and there was a shift in her stand, and the matter did get resolved. So friends, according to me, and I repeat, mediation is not a stepney. Take it up as number one. Why number one? It can resolve multiple disputes. And we have seen it happen. I have seen it happen. Not in one, in many cases. Where in a 498 at the time of bail, multiple cases got resolved. We took up washing matters also. And sometimes, in fact, I've just remembered a very interesting matter where in a quashing, the wife's brother had stabbed the husband. And this had happened many years back, and there was an order of acquittal. Or maybe I think the sentence was less and they had come up in appeal. So after we had intervened, there was a massive crying session between the brother and sister, and the matter got finally resolved. I think it was somewhere in August. So there was Raksha Bandhan during that period. They went through that also. And of course, we were not going to put the band-aid. We really wanted to know. Then we called the girl's mother-in-law, whose son had been stabbed. The boy apologized to her. He was a young fellow. He apologized to his brother-in-law. He begged forgiveness for the sake of his sister. He said that he had only done it because he was bad to his sister. And a dispute of many, many years got resolved. Yes, it is a little time consuming sometimes. As lawyers, which you are able to do more often, you're able to find out that are there chances of resolution, or this guy is only going to beat around the bush make sure the matter gets delayed by 6 months, and that's the time you must decide to say that one opportunity and no more. And similarly, I must share with you, courts are also very sensitive to these issues. And courts also don't give up the control. If after 15 days or 1 month they find there has been no progress, they say, look, we find there is no progress. We think the matter should be taken through, get back to court. And it does happen. So I've just been trying to look at the watch because I was told that there would be a question answer session. So Archana, are you ready for the question answers or what is it?
Question answer. Sir, my first yes.
Archana, are you ready for the question answers?
Yes, sir, we are ready for the question answer. Sir, the first question asked by Advocate Manisha Agarwal, who is a mediator also in High Court. So she is asking, kindly highlight difference between mediation and conciliation.
See, the roles are different. You can say conciliation and mediation are interchangeable, but they're actually not. For example, under the Labor Act, there are certain provisions of conciliation, which are not there in the mediation. So in those cases, you have to first go for conciliation. So that is one of the differences. So there may be two separate compartments for the two. Like, for example, even during arbitration, there is a concept of MEDAP, right, which is coming up, that even prior to taking up the matter in arbitration, you can have a session of mediation. But of course, there are certain boundaries there. You can't go too deep into mediation and say, okay, now I'll continue as your arbitrator. That does not happen. So conciliation is under the different act. It's under some of the labor acts. Yes.
So it was wonderful listening to you and your loving and your examples which you were giving. So there are a lot of questions which are pouring up. So the next question is of Payal Madhya, who says, when a matter is referred to the mediation by the court and the mediation is unsuccessful at the behest of one person of the parties in mediation, how does the court perceive the conduct of the party at whose behest the mediation failed?
That's a good question, Payal. In fact, I should have touched upon this. You know, a mediation can take place for 1 month or 3 months. And in case it is unsuccessful, there is only one line in the report which says mediation was a non-starter. The court will never come to know as to what was the real reason as to why mediation failed. So the mediator's report will never disclose as to Mr. X or Mr. Y was the stumbling block, or he was the one who did not allow mediation to proceed. Of course, courts are they can find out, they can also smell the rat, but never through the report. So there is no downside in this. It doesn't mean that a person can drag mediation for 6 months. Then we come back to what I was saying. You must have a very strong leash. The court must ensure that it does not become open-ended. It's really for the court to monitor it. And the mediator to monitor it. Mediator finds that this man is not cooperating, he should send the file back. And the lawyer will say, sir, nobody came from the other side. So with that statement, no prejudice is really caused. I think that will answer Payal's question.
Thank you so much, sir. That is a good answer. So the next question asked by Advocate Ridhima Gaur. She is asking that the Arbitration and Conciliation Act deals with the arbitration and conciliation matters. But so far as the mediation is concerned, there is no separate legislation for that. So she is asking whether Arbitration and Conciliation Act is sufficient for the growth, or there should be some separate specific law for that.
See, Mediation is now an established branch of ADR, and there are rules for mediation. It's not as if there are no rules. And even now under Section 12A of the Commercial Courts Act, it's part of the Act. Section 89 has also been is there, where you can refer to any of the forms of arbitration, conciliation, mediation. So it's not correct to say that we don't really need a new act for mediation. See, I firmly believe all our acts, all our sections are highly sufficient. You have five horrible rapes, doesn't mean you amend any act, right? You felt that, now for example, you just look at your CPC. According to me, in Order 37, if it is strictly followed, it takes care of all your DRT issues, all your commercial issues. Well, a little bit of tightening is important, provided it is strictly followed. What does Order 37 say? It's a commercial dispute based on dishonor of checks, hundis, bills of exchange, etc. Within 15 days, you're supposed to file your memo of appearance, then leave to defend. Decide the matter, no? Why do you need to amend all these things? Similarly, I don't think there are cases where anybody in rape cases, people get bails. Bail in a rape is an exception. And it is viewed very, very seriously. Now the POSCO Act also is there. Even otherwise, it's never granted by the asking. There have to be very, very strong reasons. And similarly, even in cases for murder, etc., our laws are in place. All our laws are in place. Yes, some implementation issues are there. For that, we are all stakeholders, courts, lawyers, judges, parties, we are all there. We all have a role to play in that. Next.
So the next question coming up is of Praveen Singh. He has an issue with the government department. So he wants to know about that he faced some issues. So kindly, advice.
Praveen is absolutely correct. In fact, they were Om's Budman appointed even for DDA, but they would not even listen to him. You see, government departments are apprehensive. The officers feel, because mediation is a settlement between two parties, it's not a settlement by court. So the parties will have to give their consent. And their fear is that suppose we give our consent and later on there is a CBI inquiry and we are asked that how did you agree for such a settlement? See, they sometimes put penalties. They put misuse charges, which run into lakhs of rupees. And even the court will strike it down. So in mediation, you will say that, look, you put interest on interest. You have put penalty from such a date when this man was not even in possession. He came into possession on such and such date. You are charging misuse charges even before he took possession. So why are you doing this? So ordinarily, what will a reasonable person will say, sir, you are right. If we did not grant him possession, how can we put misuse charges on a person? But they do that. So they are, see, again, unless we all behave like mature people, whether it's government departments or our private individuals, that is why today courts are imposing heavy cost. Why should one litigant be made to suffer because the other litigant knows it will take time? So then he should know, if I've dragged him in court for 5 years, I will not only have to pay interest, but I will have to pay actual lawyer's fee. Let's see how many people will follow this kind of litigation. First opportunity available, they say, look, I put my hands up. Please give me some time. I will make the payment. Sometimes he feels encouraged. He says, doesn't matter. I'll drag him for 10 years or 5 years. then I will ask for reduction in interest, and all right, my job is done. Such people cannot be encouraged. So government servants, government departments are a little scared that if they agree, they will be questioned. And therefore, we must set up a system where if they agree, they should not be questioned. Which means prior to agreement, if they want to get a consent of three officers, they should make a panel. They should say in case of mediation, Mr. XYZ are authorized to decide. So that no one person is blamed for it. That seems to be a practical way out.
So the next question, and I think it's a very important question in today's time, asked by Mahavir Singh Ji. He is asking, what is your take on mediation through video conferences?
See, I'll share with you that post my retirement, a mediation has been referred to me. So it is during the lockdown, the parties were talking to me and they felt that in case we don't talk amongst each other, the situation may deteriorate. And one side may, you know, break the status quo or something. So I said, all right, let me speak to all of you. I didn't use your method. I didn't use Zoom, etc. So I just did a WhatsApp video call to Mr. X, and then I put on Mr. Y also on the call. And the three of us felt that we were able to communicate. So there was another party also. So then I spoke to the other party also, and I explained to them, I said that I have been appointed as a mediator, and I, you know, followed all the rules of mediation, and I explained that this is what is my role. I'm an independent person. I'm not supposed to act on anybody's behalf, all that which I've just spoken to you. And you will have to first tell me that would you accept my being a mediator? So the person very fairly said that before I spoke to you, I was very apprehensive. But after I've spoken to you, I'm very confident, I'm on board. So we've had some three sessions. And by God's grace, I feel they were all very fruitful. And we have proceeded ahead. And I feel that we will be able to resolve the matter. I am quite confident. So I would say, yes, these are tough times. And I think we Indians have been lucky. All our tapasyas, etc., all our mandirs going to gurdwaras everywhere have worked. And this has not been so severe on us. And also because of our social distancing. We don't have facilities like the Western world. So we've been able to collectively use our resource. And whatever has been done, it's been done for the good of each one of us. So let's use this time. I've used it effectively. You are using it effectively. All our friends who are watching, they are using it effectively. Just take this time to finish all your counters and your written statements and all that. And whether it's mediation through video conferencing or it's court work, you can do it. And if nothing, all of us are back to Ludos and family bonding. You know, we belong to that section of society where we have a roof over our head and we have two square meals. I mean, I think about those who either don't have a roof or don't have two square meals. But yet, so many organizations, the government, everybody is taking on, doing their bit. More can be done, but there's always scope for more. So it doesn't mean we forget what has been done. So it is a bitter pill, but we should accept it. And as we so carefully every day look at statistics, I think one other aspect should be highlighted. I know I'm going a little astray, and that is, well, if somebody is infected, what is the next procedure? So that people are not scared for checkups. They should not be scared that, oh, if I'm infected, I don't know what will happen to me. As if somebody put me in jail, or somebody will take me away, or somebody will deprive me of something. Look, when people are unwell, they go to hospital. Here, the hospitals are coming to you. You should be grateful rather than behave in this fashion. That aside, so even during your lockdown, mediation is possible. Courts are working on, of course, urgent matters, etc. But everybody is doing something, and lots can be done. Yes, Archana.
So the next and the second last question is, sir, one Ranjit Kumar Jha wants to ask that in case the mediator is biased, what kind of remedy he has?
If it's a mediation through court, he can approach the court. If it's a private mediation, he can come out, because like I said at the very beginning, there is no force, there is no binding factor. The mediator can't hold you. He can't say no. As in the case of arbitration, there is always a remedy, and you can always make an application, or you can ask the mediator to recuse. The mediator must, in the very beginning, make a disclosure whether he knows the parties or he has any interest. And I don't think there will be somebody as irresponsible who, knowing, has any interest or is connected in any manner, would still continue his mediation. By mistake, if he has appeared for a party ages back, if it's brought to his notice, he should recuse. What is the harm? Honorable recusal is always the best.
Thank you so much, sir. So the last question asked by Median Associates, he is asking that the 5 tips for being an efficient mediator and main caution consideration while recording, sending its report.
Yes, Vijender. See, mediator, like I said, must not be a man in a hurry. From 1 to 5, that is, should not be in a hurry. Number 6, like I said, he or she should be patient, considerate, sensitive, right? To some extent, he must have a line of emotion. Now, as far as the report is concerned, if there is a settlement, friends, you have to be very careful. In many settlements, courts have found those settlements are unenforceable. One has to be very cautious. So make sure that when a settlement is drafted, for example, if in case of a dispute, there is section 468 or forgery and a charge sheet has been filed, now in your settlement you say, I'll have it quashed. Or in case there is a section of molestation or rape, you say, I will have it quashed. Now that is a very gray area. We've also come across where a person says, all right, I'm giving checks, post-dated checks of 1 crore. The plaintiff will withdraw his suit. Now you have to be very careful. If you withdraw the suit, does it mean that in case the checks bounce, he will have to go to court again? Now here you have to be very careful. You must say that the settlement is that the suit is decreed for the suit amount with interest. But in case he pays the settled amount in 12 installments by the following post-dated checks, and in case of 2 consecutive defaults, the suit would the decree would be enforceable. Now you have taken care of both the problems. In case the 12 checks get honored, the settlement has gone through. In case the man was a sham and the set checks were given only to buy time, he would end up paying the entire decreed amount. He would have conceded that I have no defense. He would have conceded to a decree. So, recording of a settlement, you must ensure, you must tell the parties, seek legal advice. And mind you, as a mediator, you're also a lawyer. So use your safeguards. All the safeguards which are there, please use them. What is the harm? I think that would answer Vijinder's question.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir, to enlighten us on this topic, and which is very useful for all the lawyers as well as litigants also. And sir, we are lucky to hear you in these times, which is, we are just, it's the best utilization of our time. Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to invite Advocate Ashok Kashyap ji, who is the president of Adhivakta Parishad Delhi High Court Unit. Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar. Yes, sir, namaskar.
Kaise ho Ashok ji?
Yes, sir, badhiya. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, I'm grateful that you have given such a nice talk and you accepted our request at the last hour. And your lecture is excellent, meaningful, as well as informative to the general public as well. And it will benefit so many viewers, those who have seen you and those who have missed, they will feel it that why they have missed it. So such a nice talk that we have heard. And I hope we'll again invite you for further discussions. And this is our study circle, sir. This is second study circle on the live TV. So we are planning to have it. So I also must thanks to my team, Archana ji, Archit, and those who are working from behind, as well as national office bearers, Shri V.M. Bharda ji, who appreciated our program very much. So I also thank you. I also thank you, sir, viewers, those who have seen your program. Thank you very much, sir, once again.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.